is the feeling. Take me to the garden. I wanna feel my belonging.
Coming up in the Garden of Eden tonight.
Right, I will welcome you back tonight in the Garden of Eden. And yes, we are still here enjoying the conversation that we had last week. As you can see, I am starting the show saying we welcome you back. For those of you that watched part one of the interview that we aired last week with Mr. and Mrs. Arinaitwe or Izara here, Becky and Andrew, they are telling us their story of how they went through something that was a little bit challenging, but yes, they are here to testify of the goodness of the Lord, of the strength of their vow, the covenant that they made on the day of their wedding. And of course, we told you, those of you that were with us in part one last week, that we were looking at the meaning of the vows that we make on the wedding day. Do we actually mean them? Do we understand what we are getting ourselves into, or we are just following the trend? And you repeat after the priest. You see, they said you repeat after me, so you just repeat and say whatever they say and you walk away. But when the time comes for that very word that you said to be tested, you want to run away, you want to flee and quit on your life partner. Okay, Andrew and Becky, welcome back in the Garden of Eden.
Thank you.
I'm going to ask you for this moment to just take a minute and do a little bit of an introduction of who you are for the purpose of those that are just watching this episode for the first time, and then we'll go back to where we stopped last week.
Thank you very much. I am Andrew and this is Rebecca. She's my wife. And we have been married for 15 years now. We have 4 children, 3 biological and 1 that the Lord gave us recently. So Andrew and Rebecca are also pastors of a church.
Yes,
we didn't say last time.
Yes,
we didn't say that. Yeah, we pastor the church at the Upper Room Church in Kampala, which is a part of a network of upcoming churches. Our headquarters are in Mbarara. There's something good coming out of Mbarara. You should go there and see one day. Yes. But for the last maybe 10 years, we have been doing something called Spouses Nuggets.
Yes,
which
yes.
is...
We didn't.
Which is a forum for married people, where married people can find safe space to share experiences, to learn together, and to build their marriages. We do that with my wife and so many other lovely people around the world, around the country. And marriage is beautiful. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Indeed.
Yeah.
Glory to God. Okay. Yeah. So for those of you that are saying, hey, marriage anchor, we are here for the first time, give us a recap. You know, we are not going to give you a recap, but I will recommend that you go to our YouTube channel now. If you don't have a smartphone, it is okay. Stay connected to the Garden of Eden. Maybe in the future, we'll have to do a repeat and air part one that you missed. But for those of you that do not have smartphones, you have to bear with us. We can't redo everything that we did last week, but those of you with smartphones, with computers, laptops, you can go to our YouTube channel at Marriage Anchor. Look for the picture of this lovely couple. You see, that is part one that we are doing when we are understanding the vows. And of course, the title will be In Sickness and in Health. Can you stand the test when it's time for you to remain committed to your vows? Okay, so before we concluded last week, we had reached at a part where you were telling us how you were man enough and willing to wait sexually and abstain. And we thank you that we should applaud. We should do clap for him for proving that indeed he is strong enough. And of course, not by might, by power, but by the Spirit of the Lord. Okay, so at this point, I want us to go through Okay, maybe for just a little bit of a summary, these guys went through a challenging circumstance health-wise that she fell sick for some good time, and then he had to leave or forsake a lot of things to be able to take care of her for a period of 6 months. And of course, we are looking at how they handled that, how challenging it was, their families, the children, and of course, right now, the recovery process, everything in between that you'll be able to get in our part one. Now we are at a part where I want us to talk about the role played by our parents, because most times you may be committed as husband and wife to your vows, but then there are people that did not leave emotionally. They left only physically, but they are still attached to their parents psychologically. They consult them in everything, like you said, and then you're still thinking of, you know, committing and abstaining, and then a family member is influencing or even arranging some sort of something that is inappropriate as far as your personal values are concerned. Let me start with Becky. How should we treat outsiders as we are working together as a team?
It is not that easy, I must say, because we've grown with our parents for quite some time. We have learned from them. We still learn from them. So breaking away completely is hard. I will not speak for many of us who are married, but I'll just give an example. How do we go about it? My husband and I agreed, and this is how we do it. When it comes to a part where I have to deal with people from my side, I deal. Questions, everything to do with people from my side, it is me. I deal with them.
Yes.
When it comes to his side, I do not have to get involved in any way. So he deals with everything, questions everything, his side, him. And that has helped us a lot, because we don't get to clash with either side. Because you know your people better. You've stayed with them long enough. So you know how to approach them, what to say, when to say it. So that keeps us safe. The same as their family. So.
But now, I think there was an issue there. What if now, in me talking to my side of the family, there's an active recruiter in that group? How do you think?
Yeah, because you never intervene, so you do not know what kind of information they are getting. Does he come and update you of what they are of what
yes.
they have said?
Yes, actually he updates me. It might not be on that very day. You know how men talk, they talk in parts.
Headlines.
Yes. Today there are headlines, tomorrow it's first part, the next day is the second part. So if you keep the conversation, you can follow through. You can know that this is actually coming from the previous conversation. So he updates me. So if there is any kind of influence, I give my views, what I think about it. And I don't dwell so much on it. Only if it gets into my space. I don't know. Should I say my space? If it has a way of affecting me, I will still tell him that I don't think that is really going to work.
But you know, it's a responsibility. So what we have done is that I have taken the responsibility that when it comes to the affairs of managing my family as far as she's concerned, she should be able to trust me and rely on me, that I am not going to be doing things behind her back. Same thing also for her. She does not go the other side and have things that she can't tell me about, right? So we have to trust that the other person has the other person's interest at heart. If you don't establish that, this system won't work. It won't work for you. If you don't, because you have to be able, I have to be able to say to myself, so as long as she's handling, I'm safe. But as soon as I discover that, I am not safe, I may be forced to put in place mechanisms for my own safety. And that is how problems
arise.
Big problems arise. But I think there are issues. You raised something also which we can speak into. When, for instance, it comes to giving birth, you have been married a couple of years and you haven't had a child. And even me, I find myself falling to that temptation. People have been married and I'm like, are they pregnant yet? Have they had a child?
Have a baby?
Yeah. I think it is.
It's
a what?
Yes. What's going on? Uh-huh. What's the problem? That curiosity is human, but it can be very, very painful. And people need to, we need to really be careful before we start exploring it too deeply. If someone volunteers the information and talks to you, and I have people who talk to me like that, then have some respect and listen and do more listening than talking. So if it comes to now family members pressurizing you, this is where you have to fall back to commitments that you made to one another. And those commitments were not lightweight things. These are you are just set for yourself how you want your life as a married couple to be. If you have to disconnect yourself from those people actively, please do it. I know that it sounds a bit rough on some family members, but your primary family is this one.
Yeah.
Okay, my primary family is this one. So if you want to get in the middle of this little thing we are trying to do, I am sorry for you. You are the meat.
Yeah. You'll be eaten.
Yes. Yes. This here is a holy ground.
No.
This is holy ground.
Yes.
And she needs to feel. I don't know if she feels like that.
Yes. I feel like that. I feel protected. You know, people use the information you give them to get into your space.
Yeah.
So it you have to know what to tell them. Don't. We talk too much. We want to do too much explanations. There's no need. For me, I just give what they can use. We are working on this. We've thought about it. We are still discussing this. Don't open up your house for everybody to have an opinion, for everybody to decide for you. No, we have not done that. And I like that he said that you build this over time. I am not thinking that he's going to go behind me and say something negative. So our relationship has got to work for him to go and actually represent me well. If it is not working, he likes his people. He will go back and tell them, I don't feel comfortable, but if our relationship is working, I'm not afraid.
Yeah.
I'm not afraid that he's going to go behind and say, I don't think that woman is doing this well. Or, no. If this is fine,
then
Diana is covered. Yeah.
That's really good. Okay, so at this point, I would like us to get into discussing expectations and, of course, using your experience, what you went through, and perhaps some other things that are not health related. Now, most of us get into this marriage with a big vision, with a big dream. We have watched things on TV, we have seen our neighbors, remember, seen from the outside, we are looking at and we think they have been something great and lush. And so we want to have what our neighbors have. We want to see and have an experience what we see on Instagram.
Did you say Instagram?
Instagram.
Do
you have an account?
Yes, I do.
For example, matching colors. You might want to introduce matching colors as someone like, who are you branding? We are no longer in kindergarten or in primary school. So we get into the marriage and everybody has expectations.
Oh, yes.
And maybe let me just stress the difference. People think they know what they need from a marriage. And then they are wants. And then there are roles. So I want us to get into expectations, define it, and then get into wants and then needs, so that someone that is watching will be able to actually understand what you should expect. Because we always have failed expectations because we expect things that are not even there and realistic. We don't even know what we are meant or supposed to, what marriage was designed to provide. So let's just use your example, maybe, and then we'll go into discussing the rest. At the time when you were, when she was not feeling well, now that was a failed expectation of the things of the companion she was supposed to be providing. Did you ever get disappointed, generally or emotionally?
I wish she wasn't sick, because then I felt like this sickness was interrupting our usual very cozy life. You know, But I also had an understanding that when she's not sick, she's not like this. Yeah. And by the way, having a sick person is a difficult thing. Mm. It's a difficult thing for the person who's sick. Mm. It's also difficult for the person who is taking care of the person.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because the person who is sick feels like, these things I used to do for myself. Mm. Now I'm telling you to please give me a cup.
Because I'm unable to.
And you are taking so long to give me a cup. What can be so hard? Just give me a cup. And then this guy is like, when you told me to give you a cup, I had a knife, I had onions, my hands were wet, I'm drying my hands, I'm just going to pass the cup to you. But where is all this impatience? Mm. You know, and it can easily be very, very explosive. But anyway, talking about expectations, usually we draw expectations from observations, from people we have observed, maybe our parents. Maybe our uncles or aunties, people we admire. Mm. And these days, we are not short of those. You can even draw inspiration from the internet, from the marriage. Thank you very much. Yes, yes.
But you don't even know how
you have never met her.
You just see her on TV and
that's the one. Yes.
And you have no clue what's happening.
Absolutely. Mm. And let me say that we need to, the Bible says, do not think yourself more highly than you ought to think. It just calls for humility and for appreciating where you are. Mm-hmm. My situation and her situation is a complete world away from your experience. Mm-hmm. Everyone will have their own experiences. So make your own experiences. Don't try to translate what is in someone's, what you think is in someone's life, and you're just going to just lift it and paint it in your life. It is not, it may not work. It could work, but lucky you if it works. But it's likely not to work. And if it doesn't work, you're going to be, your expectation is not going to be met. Let me first say this, I'm feeling very clever right now.
Yeah.
Your expectations are not going to be met. Then you're going to be disappointed. If disappointment stays long enough, it is going to bring
bitterness.
The sense of looking at someone, just see someone, your heart starts going very fast, because not because you love him, but because you're like, can he die? Can he die?
Mm.
You know? And when the Bible says that when bitterness comes up, it shoots up trouble.
Mm-hmm.
And so trouble starts coming from places you don't know in your marriage. You're like, how did you even arrive at this point? But in fact, you were disappointed. The Bible says that a man offended is harder to win than a fortified city.
Wow.
Now, I'd like to add a small extension to that.
Mm-hmm.
If a man offended is harder to win than a fortified city, a woman is worse.
I was waiting for that.
Yeah,
me too.
Anyway,
because we are always the emotional wreck.
And marriage has very many opportunities for us to be offended. Why? It is a spiritual thing that happens primarily in an emotional environment.
Yeah.
And the reason that it happens is because God wanted us to enjoy it,
mm-hmm.
you know. But the devil knows how to mess up things. Mm-hmm. So a thing which we're supposed to enjoy then becomes a sticky thorn, and people can't talk to each other, mm-hmm. and people are just, you know, looking at each other very, very badly. Because we had unrealistic expectations.
Yeah.
What do I recommend? What do we recommend? What do we do?
Mm.
We try to discuss our expectations about just about everything.
Mm.
Before we got married, she said, look in the future and tell me what you'll be doing when you are a middle-aged man. I said, this girl, she has come for me for sure. I even remember where I think we were taking a walk somewhere, someplace. Yeah,
okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And I said, well, I will be in full time ministry for sure. That's what I know for that for sure.
At that time, you knew.
Yeah, I knew. I've known for a long time. It just took a long time to decide. And she's like, yeah. Now, compare this with another friend of mine who, those days, we were good friends. We liked each other. We were involved in church. And she told me, I can never marry a pastor. That for me, it did it for me. I was like, this girl, even if I wanted her much,
if I should marry
somebody that you were friends with before.
Yeah, before Becky. Mm. She said, I can never marry a pastor. She went on to marry a good friend of ours and they're fine.
And deep down you knew that at a certain time too, you'd have to get into full-time ministry.
I knew it.
So that was you
know, for me, that sorted me. In having a conversation, if you hear someone continuously saying, I cannot marry a pastor.
I cannot be with a person who's like this.
You have to have money.
I don't want children. Mm-hmm. And you want children.
And then you're like, I love her. Uh-huh. Maybe she will change and adjust.
You say, let me marry this person. Mm-hmm. My friend, you have lit the fire for yourself. The Bible says, when a tree is cut, where it falls,
that's where it lies.
Which means that if you are seeing these things like this, what makes you think it is going to be different? Mm-hmm. In other words, you get what you see.
Yeah.
So let's be honest with ourselves. I can't be dishonest with her. She cannot now say, I didn't know you were going to become a pastor. Okay? Mm-hmm. And you know, pastors are not billionaires, most of them. Okay, maybe they are.
These days.
I take it back, pastors. Friends, I take it back.
We are loaded.
Mm.
And we want you to be a loaded
pastor.
Oh, yes.
Of course, we will. But the point I'm making is you could not expect a certain even if pastor is a billionaire, their commitment and the commitment of their money is to the ministry, is to the sheep, those are the things. When I come home, the things I'm excited about, she'll tell you, I'm excited about things. And she's like, okay, how does that fit into our marriage? I can be so excited. The other day, when we found out we were going to be pastors, we uplifted everything, children, what? I think even the dog, from one church to a new church.
Wow.
There's a major change. Our last born just said, you're making too many changes. Yeah, he had to come to terms. Fortunately, he, again, like I said, we have raised our children to believe that when it's time to go, we will go, and they should not have a problem with it. So you already can see where this brother is going, where this sister is going, but you still maintain expectation. You know this guy is not a rugged driver, but you want the life of a rugged driver. And then you marry this guy who's a fisherman. Good luck.
Indeed. You already failed before you start.
Exactly.
So I think building on that, expectations can be flexible.
Yeah.
Oh yes, absolutely.
Yes. You can change. There's room for adjustment. Mm. When it comes to needs, I don't think they are. Mm. It's what you can't do without. Mm. When it comes to needs, it's what you really need to survive, to live, to thrive. Those are needs. When it comes to roles, it is how you were made to function.
Yes,
if I was made a woman, God put in me everything to be a mother, a homemaker, a wife, a head, all those things.
Oh.
And those things actually bring fulfillment.
Yeah, true.
Your role brings fulfillment. I don't know about the husbands, but I think even when they provide,
they're
excited.
Absolutely.
I can do it. Yes, I can do it. Yes, it brings about significance. You feel important.
Yeah.
You feel valued. Mm. So with the roles, it's what you are and how you're supposed to function.
Yeah,
with the needs, it's what you can't do without. You need it to survive and to live.
Mm.
And then with the expectations.
Or with the wants. Both the wants.
The needs and the wants all can fall under expectations.
Mm.
Okay?
True.
But with the wants you can see, can you afford to take me to, I don't know, which place? I look into it and I'm like, I don't think we can afford it
now.
You
want it.
I want it.
Let me just make a small example of what the woman would want.
Exactly.
It is not a need.
Mm-hmm.
That you'd open the card door for us.
Oh.
And hold my hand in public everywhere that we go.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We want that.
If we have a car.
We want that. We want that.
Absolutely.
To be able to
open the car door, we want you to sweep, continuously sweep us off our feet and carry us to bed. We want a kiss in the morning, good night, and then a kiss, in the evening, a kiss in the morning, good morning, and then in the evening, good night. Mm. Like, we want those little affectionate things, but sometimes we cannot die if we don't get it, but
yes,
we
absolutely
want it. But someone can make a fuss over just the fact that he never holds her hand when they're in public, and they are fighting over that because he does not hold her hand when they're in public or around church.
Yes.
Why do you walk ahead of me?
Mm-hmm. Why are you ashamed,
ashamed of me?
Are you ashamed of me? You have any other person in this church.
You're right. So it's true. And that's what she said. There are things that we would want in the ideal situation. And these things are either possible or impossible. If they are possible, then the other spouse should know them, should try to bring them on as much as is possible. The problem with a lot of us is that we expect, and I'm using that word deliberately, we expect him to know what I should need without telling him. Now, he may be important, he may be anointed, but he is not a mind reader. Alright? Yeah, you need to ask me. He's not a mind reader. And she's not a mind reader. Now, let me also flip it over. Ladies, when you talk to the man about what you expect and what you want, don't say it once. Did that make sense?
Repeat yourself.
Don't say it once. Repeat it at some point.
Won't you consider her for nagging?
Yes,
exactly.
That is why you
that's
always
serious.
Tell us.
That's serious.
You see, ladies, and I know Becky, every woman does this, because we had this conversation in the marriage fellowship, and I would be trying to remind you of what you said.
And I'll be nagged.
And actually, you agreed and said you are going to make adjustments. But honey, you see the way you start coming home.
Now you're nagging.
Thursdays, you said we set apart Thursdays for date night, so that you can come and we just cuddle in the chair and everybody's in bed. But you're still coming back at 10. You're not making but you're nagging me. So how do we strike a balance between the continuous reminder and the husband mistaking it for nagging?
So this is where it becomes nagging. When your nice reminder becomes a quarrel, becomes 2 weeks of not talking, becomes an argument, becomes the problem is A, but we're arguing about C, but the problem is A. So we are not able to tell where the problem is exactly. And we are handlers, we are solvers. So if you're complaining about the cups in the kitchen, but in fact the problem is the hugs and the cuddling, I will solve the cups and I'll leave you with your what?
With
your hugs and
the
I'll leave you hugless. Alright? Yes. So and then also I personally prefer to be reminded. I prefer to be reminded. Even though I don't always like it, I prefer to be reminded.
In a nice
way. It doesn't even have to be a nice way, just remind me. You say, you know, we're supposed to be doing this and it affects me when we don't do it. Okay? And the reminder cannot come from a blaming point of view. It comes from me telling.
What's wrong with you?
Aha.
You said you
aha
will do this.
Now that's
why
a problem.
Don't you keep your promises?
Now that's a problem.
So the husband is being scolded.
Yes. Yet, if she came and said, Friday night we agreed it's supposed to be date night. We have done 3 weekends without it. It's creating a gap. I feel like not having it is creating a gap. So she's not accusing me. She's just telling me how she feels. I care about her. So because I care about her, now and I realize that there is a gap created by my absence on Friday, it is likely that appointments are going to be rescheduled someplace to make room for her. I may do it for 3 times and skip and forget. And she says, our little thing was working. See that reminder?
Yeah.
It's now you stopped again. Then it's more gentle and more considerate. If I say, okay, I know we're supposed to have that day, but last Friday, you know, I had to take the kid to hospital and then that thing got disorganized. So in other words, I'm saying that didn't count. But can you do it another day? Right? So a man needs to be reminded.
Politely.
I think that's what we're looking for.
Respectfully.
Rather than having a roster at home where you tick, pass and fail. Mm-hmm. And the man comes back and says, oh, wretched man, what did I do? Same thing with husbands. Mm-hmm. And for husbands, the one thing that will agitate us is when we don't have sex as often as we want.
Okay.
Now I'm saying it on national television. Please, when you see me, when you see me on the streets, we can have this conversation. But anyway, some have gone to the point of keeping Excel sheets of what happened and what she said, why she didn't want a backache, tired, the kids will hear us. You hear those things? And the neighbors, not a good time, it's too hot, you know. It's the same thing. You want to come to a consensus with her, knowing that we are both working on getting together rather than me getting what I want because I want it and then not caring about her. What is the overarching thing for good marriages is that we are all looking out for one another.
Yeah,
I don't want to have something that she's not enjoying. And I'm sure she also doesn't want to have something that I am not enjoying. If it's going to be a cuddle, but in my heart I'm grumbling, I think it's not going to work.
Actually, we will feel, you will know that it's just your, because even a simple touch, if your mind, if you're stressed and tired, you can come and touch and you'll be like, what's wrong with you? Like, the touch will be empty. I tell people that every gesture that you do is, you're communicating. It's a form of communication, the eye contact, that touch. Cool. Because remember, when you are dating, you just touch her and she will feel everything that you're feeling. Exactly.
Mm.
When you touch somebody with caring hands, they will know.
When you touch them because you're touching them.
You're just touching them like, why? Like, it's just empty.
Right.
Exactly.
So,
that touch at night.
Mm. Hey. Anyway, so we would like to do things that are mutual, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's something that we both like. Incidentally, even husbands like to cuddle, except that...
Or just you, Andrew.
No, except that the cuddling will end somewhere.
Of course, almost naturally. For you like it because it is it is just a starter to your main course.
That counts, doesn't it?
Mm. And we love it. We love as long as the process is elongated.
Yes, absolutely.
You don't rush to do the main course.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And even that takes practice, you know. So we may want something so badly, but how we bring out what we want can determine whether we are going to get it or not. And some things we actually want are impossible.
Mm-hmm.
They are undoable, at least in the short term. Okay. And we need to, like you're saying, we need to be flexible.
Mm-hmm.
Marriage calls for flexibility. You have to be flexible. When we got married, I don't think I could even take out a date or something, a serious date or something like that. Why? No, I probably can.
Why did you think that you couldn't?
I couldn't. Would wash the dishes after that. I didn't want to do that. Yeah, I couldn't put her in a risky situation. Now, probably much better, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so we're not where we were, okay?
Mm-hmm.
But what has it taken? A lot of patience, a lot of flexibility, a lot of understanding. There are things she couldn't do voluntarily when we just got married. She has had to adapt them because she knows they're important to me. And that's how it works.
Okay.
That's how it works. It's not a question of we like each other, we are married, let's get married, and then everything will be fine.
Mm-hmm.
I think the other expectation which we need to look into is what people imagine is going to happen as soon as they finish the wedding.
Mm-hmm.
I think that the wedding has become more important than the marriage itself.
Yeah, the lifetime.
Yes. Huh?
I think even us who are married, we probably don't help the people that are going to get married.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
We blow things, like we want to show.
There's
like,
a lot of pretense.
I don't think it, yes, there is that.
Mm-hmm.
But I also think we...
Misrepresentation?
No, let me put it this way.
Mm-hmm.
You want to measure up for something.
Okay.
Yes. probably your parents didn't tell you you're valued, you're loved, you're good, and so you want to show it through what you can do.
Yeah.
Okay? They will know, I am capable. I am able to do this.
You're trying to prove a point?
You're trying to prove a point.
Yeah, true.
And so you prove the point, you get married.
Mm.
And now when it gets to practicals, things are not working.
You don't know what to do and you don't want to ask.
And you can't ask because you're proving a point.
Yeah.
Now you're stuck. You don't know how to proceed.
Woe unto the wife.
So for me, I think when it comes to a lady, mm-hmm. we talk on behalf of the ladies,
mm-hmm.
our expectations are more like what we look out for when we are dating.
Yeah.
Are you checking on me? Hmm? Am I the centerpiece? Like, I have to be...
Am I your priority?
Exactly. Like, am I the one? Like, do you think about me that much the way you used to think about me that time?
Yeah.
And it can be... That is an expectation, but it can also be wrong because marriage has seasons.
Yeah, true.
At a certain point, yes, that has happened. But as you grow and responsibilities increase, that changes. And so you're not the focus, and that breaks us.
Yeah.
And we don't know even how to deal with it. And we can't even put it in words. But we want to be that center of attraction. We want the man to think about us, call on us, text us. So I think understanding one another helps us, in addition to communication, understanding one another helps us to know your partner. I worked in a bank and we had this common phrase, KYC.
Mm.
Know your client.
Wow.
So here is know your partner, know your customer, know your client, whatever name you want to put there, but know your client. Know what suits them because it's general. Society shapes, okay? There's a way they've shaped how we're supposed to think. If a man likes you, they're supposed to do this for you.
Yeah,
so for you, use it as your checklist.
Yes.
Okay, checklist. You go and check. You're not doing this for me. You're not doing this for me.
Therefore,
don't love me.
And then there's a disappointed man on the other side thinking,
I'm doing my best.
Yeah.
So I think when you add up the choices we make, the upbringing, the circumstances we've gone through, all those things, when you combine them, they form a person. Okay? So every husband, every wife is unique.
Yeah.
And so is marriage. Every marriage is unique, like you said. So my expectations could be general, but there are also priorities among the expectations. So I gauge, I'm like, can I expect this from him? Can he do this? Can he help me with this? If the expectation can't be met, I need to have told myself that he loves me. Like this, I don't know how to say it, but you agree with yourself prior. Because when that expectation that is not met finds when you're not prepared in your heart, it can bring that disappointment that he was talking about. So for me, I do self-awareness. I check myself. I ask myself, what do I want? Can it be got? If it can't be got, what can I do? What can I do in its place? So that I'm not overwhelming him with what I really, really want. The only issue I think would come is when it is a need. You can't do without it. Like it has to be done for you to move from one step to another. So that is where like the disappointment comes in and you're like, it is a need.
But then that's where we now have to manage it. I think it would be unfair for one spouse to be having, even if it is something you want, and it cannot be met all of the time, you know?
Okay, Andrew, let me just add in this because I believe it's going to fit into exactly what you are going to say. I wanted to ask maybe what we can advise people that are watching, and for them, they come into the marriage with open hands, waiting to receive. So someone gets into this relationship and all they want is for everything that they need and want and desire from their spouse to be done, yet they are not willing to put in a little bit of an effort to meet the other person's need. So it is about them, me, myself, and I. You must do this for me, you must do this, you must do this. But this person also has needs and they are not willing to give, they are only expecting to receive.
You know, that now introduces a complication. Because it's a relationship. It is, you're supposed to function in helping one another. In it's not
complimenting.
It's supposed to compliment one another. You know? So if someone comes in with an attitude of a taker, at the least it is selfish.
Yeah.
And that's not good. Marriage is selfless in its nature, in its design. In fact, it's so selfless. Like, this is what God says to the husbands, that you should love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave up his life for her.
The church.
So if you have not given up your life,
die to self.
Die. If you've not, to the point of death, we still have some room for improvement. All right? So we come into marriage
To serve one another. Explain that death. See, I don't want people to just take, oh, death. What kind of death are you talking about? Especially on the side of the husband. Because they want that stress. I have told this before in the garden, but I would want you, for example, what you guys went through while you waited for her to recover, you died to whatever need. Didn't matter when it, whether it was priority or not, you died. So when you talk about dying to self, just as Christ died for the church, what kind of death? Please give examples.
Let me give you an example. I like my sleep. I don't sleep long, but I sleep short and sound. So I don't want interruptions. No kid interrupting, no yelling at night, no crying, nothing. I don't like it. When we gave birth to our first child, I saw how it drained my wife. So when the kid would cry at night, I couldn't think of any other way than to go fetch the kid, put the kid on the breast, carry the kid after the kid has finished feeding, take back to the bed and cover. Should the kid wake up in the process, I forget my sleep and cry. And I did that for all the three children.
Wow,
you know, wonderful. I don't like it.
But you had to give it up.
For her. Because I needed her to be rested fully.
A little bit.
Yes. Because I go to work in the morning, I come back in the evening and she's like, please take. She's tired.
I know.
She's draining. You know? I don't like kids to susu on me. I don't like
changing a diaper.
So, instantly, because I don't like kids to swim me, I have to buy diapers and I have to change them
before it fills up, and you don't want it leaking anywhere.
I don't want, but even then, I know that it takes the burden off of her. You know, that's one of many. What am I doing? I am taking on something that I'm personally uncomfortable with, so as to give her relief.
Comfort.
Yes. And she would do probably similar things. There are things she would not be, maybe she would tell us one example. There are things she would not be comfortable, but she knows that I need them done for me, and she does them. I'm not a very organized person. No.
You're not an organized
person. Oh yeah, thank you very much. Do you know her? She was thinking about my clothes and my shirts a month ago. And me, I can wake up, throw on a jean, a hat, and that's it.
He's a fisherman.
The round ones.
Yes. So, dying to self, for me, is saying, okay, when it comes to this person, I'll put my own desires on the side, even if temporarily, in order to serve them. And marriage is about service.
Yeah.
It's about service. You serve one another. And when we have done that, our marriage has been vibrant.
Yeah.
When each one of us has sought their own way, You enter a house and you could cut through the tension with a knife. Mm. What has gone?
It's very thick.
Yes.
Tangible.
Hey. Until we sit down and say, you know, I don't like to talk. This thing of, let's talk.
Let's talk.
For me,
is
once.
There a man who loves to talk?
I don't
know. Yes, I have yet to meet a husband or a man who says, I love to talk. Like when you say, honey, we need to talk. What did I do? They
exactly.
want to avoid and create excuses. Even when you just want some, because you said the husband, biology has said that a man, the way you're wired, that you only have one side of your brain working at a time. So you cannot use both sides like us. You can't handle multitasking. And so because of that, every time I have something constructive or an idea that I want us to brainstorm, you're always busy. Your mind is focused on something. And because of that, I know that if I come and just interrupt your schedule, maybe you're doing a research, or perhaps it is that you have a game on your mind, or there's something on your mind, you will not pay attention and I'll be wasting my time. So the need for us to call you to attention to a moment where you clear your head and we talk is that I want you to be able to give me 100%
attention
mm-hmm. and actually listen, so that I don't have to keep repeating myself and like, what did you say? But then you avoid it, thinking I am going to nag you.
Not only avoid it,
I think what disturbs the most, I learned that over the years, is when we mention, can we talk? Or let's
we
talk.
We need to talk.
Mm.
We need to talk.
Definitely
now,
something
that one
wrong
doesn't
there.
Work for them. I learned that when you need to talk, talk.
Just say.
Like, talk. Don't be organized in, let's talk. Because for them, they are... The way they were made, they are protectors, they are fighters, security, whatever, what we're talking about. So they're always in fight mode to protect. So when you say,
oh,
let's,
even.
Yes, mm. when you say, let's talk.
There are two choices.
For them, they're just thinking,
fight
now,
it.
What is this?
Run away from it.
And so they can easily attack you or defend themselves or dodge. So me, I think I learned, let's talk. Or in between conversations, bring the issue.
Slot it in.
Don't wait. Don't introduce the talk. Don't say, let's talk. I think I learned that over time. That conversation is important for a woman. It is very important.
Number two need it ranks that high.
Like men will say, I don't have that time to talk. But now there, you're not dying to say, you're not dying to self. You're not committing yourself to say, I understand that it is your need. Someone will tell you, I'm busy. Or, talk about what?
What do you want us to talk about?
Like, what do you want to talk about? So that is not only rude, but you're opening up your wife to somebody else who's going to talk to her.
Yeah.
If got somebody to talk to her. If got somebody to talk to her. Because the Lord made women a certain way to nurture children. And so we are conversational. So when you deny your wife that moment to talk, you're telling God, that you put in that woman is not very important. That woman has is not, what can I say? Like, in a way you're demeaning God. So conversation is important. The only problem me I think has been there is how we introduce the talking. But I've been privileged. We talk. Actually, we talk. We can talk. But there are people who tell you the words are few. 3, 4, done. Other moments, I don't want to talk.
But we didn't always talk. We didn't always talk.
Yes, I think it started after some time.
Yes, and this is how it started. Someone had to say, this talking has to be talked.
Wow.
Even though it is not my piece of cake. Right? So I had to find, how can we do it? So I started saying, please, when we need to talk, let's just talk. Don't announce we need to talk. Don't say, on Thursday we'll talk. Because I will not work between that day and that Thursday. I will not be working. My head will just be buzzing.
What did I do?
I will audit my life from when I was born up to that point, trying to find what is wrong with me. What have I now done to deserve? We need to talk, you know? And it comes from a place of authority when you say we need to talk, rather than from a place of friendship. And you know, husbands, we want to talk to someone side by side rather than
confrontational, like face to face. So you girls want to sit, hold hands, whisper, talk over a cup of tea, and smile and giggle.
Yes.
And for us, if something is up in your face,
in
it is asking.
Yes, he has changed.
It is asking, can I fight you? Can I defeat you if I fight you? That is this in your face kind of thing is a challenge. It's a challenge.
Mm.
So when you say we need to talk, that's the posture I'm thinking about.
Okay. Mm.
But when we hold hands and we take a walk
and we talk,
and in the process, I'm looking at the trees, but you're talking. Mm. I'm hearing you. The problem is that many women feel like
if
he's not paying attention.
Yes.
So the way we talk is different from the way you talk. When I talk to my brothers, we can say, Mom, you know how this thing is. Hmm? Mm. I've tried like 3 times and it's not working. He's like, hey, have you thought about this? You know, he's not standing in my face and giving me a talking down. You know, so it is that which changed that helped our ability to have a conversation. I didn't always like it. Sometimes even these days, maybe I don't like it when I'm like very busy, but I'm like, it is important. So dying to self comes down to someone saying, I don't enjoy it yet, but for the sake of my wife or my husband, it's got to be done.
Yeah.
It's got to be done.
All right. Okay, at this moment, allow us to take a sip on a cup of coffee. We'll be back in just a moment. Don't you go anywhere, but we still have Becky and Andrew right here in the Garden of Eden. Welcome back from that short break. You're still in the Garden of Eden with your marriage anchor, Prosy Brionda. And yes, at this moment, we are trying to bring this conversation that we've been having since last week with Mr. and Mrs. Izara, Becky and Andrew. And yes, if you missed the beginning, part one that we aired last week, and of course, where we started from tonight, I would like to encourage you to go to our YouTube channel at Marriage Anchor and be sure to watch part one. And then when the show is done, now it is streaming on our YouTube channel, you can be able to watch it tomorrow, next week, and of course, send the link to your friends. And while you're there, remember to subscribe, okay? So maybe, Becky, I would like you to be the first to answer. Now that we talked about a little bit of conversation as an important need for the ladies, and then we talked about affection, I remember we touched it. What other needs, not wants, needs, things that you think a lady cannot do without?
Thank you. The other need that I think I cannot do without, like I told you, the ladies have different priorities, is freedom, the liberty to know more about him, the openness. Like, we are free. He tells me everything. He's not secretive, like hiding stuff from me. He's open, okay? I don't worry about him. I'm not looking over my shoulder, thinking, what is going to happen? When is the common thing is, when is another wife coming? Like, where is the property going?
Who is he funding? Where is he spending the rest of the money? Why has money disappeared from our joint account?
Yes, those things. I'm not in that category. At least I am not. Because it can be draining. I have counseled a number of women in that area. It can be very frustrating where you're looking for, or you're looking over your shoulder, you're not sure. So if something happened to him, or somebody told me something about him, I can know that this is truth or not truth, because he doesn't have two sides. All that I see is what I get, is what I see. And that has kept us, I can say it has built our trust. I can trust him in everything. I am not worried about anything to do with him in that area. I am not worried. So I think every lady wants that kind
security.
Of...
It's a need
because anxiety. You know, they already have that load of emotional...
The uncertainty.
Yes, that emotional load that they have. When you add in uncertainty, like they are not sure, then they become nosy. When they become nosy, they become nagging.
Yeah.
So I think
because they're trying to be make sure that it is safe.
It is safe for them. For them. Mm. So for me, I think you don't lose much, especially if you're a Christian. If you're not a Christian, I don't know how you do it, because they'll tell you, ladies, these days you can't tell them everything. Mm. You can't tell your lady everything. You can't, as a man, in case something goes wrong, you can't trust them. So should he fall, he will not fall. But if something like that happens, I am not using a panga or looking through the wind and saying, finally, I have got you.
Mm.
No, I know it has happened. I can then extend grace.
Mm.
Because it's all been well. Yeah. So if something goes below, I am not worried.
Okay. Andrew, can I ask you, did you know that she needed that? Like, that is something
I didn't
that
know
is
that
important
she needed.
To her?
I didn't know
or
that
you
she
just
needed.
Do it out of your own character and belief as a man, as the person, as Andrew.
More like that. I didn't think that she needed it.
That it was that important.
That important. And it wasn't exactly natural to me.
Mm.
It's not comfortable. Let's say, for instance, I don't look at her phone or see what is in there, but I'll leave my phone there. And now, something.
Without a password.
She has my password.
She knows the password.
So when she needs to, and she needs to look into my phone. Why? Because I do many things. I'm a fisherman, a full-scale fisherman. I do businesses. I also do speaking engagements. I have a church. So I can have appointments that we are supposed to share that I thought I told her, and I didn't. So now she needs to go through some of my chats, things to follow up on, you know, kids' meetings at school and what have you, things that I won't be able to track in real time. I'll probably remember them, but if we need to do it together, well, she needs to be prepared early. So she's free to look through my phone. Now, that's not comfortable, because it's easy to see something in my phone and
misinterpret.
Yes, what is that? So I can worry about that. But I told her, if you find something you don't understand, bring it to me. Okay, let's look at it. And I think that she has now taken that trust and used it so properly that it has alleviated that fear from me. So if she's looking through my phone and she's something she doesn't understand, she's going to bring it up to me, and then we're going to discuss it like adults, not quarreling, not, I don't expect to come home and there's a frying pan in my face and that kind of stuff. What did I see in your phone? No, no. Because she has access to my thing. But also she cleans out my appointments and she takes note of them, and she runs it. You have this on this day.
She will check on your calendar to see your appointments.
Yes, yes. Without your permission. Some of these are not even in my calendar, my friend. Some of these things are in WhatsApp chats.
She goes through your WhatsApp chats and reminds you of things that
she said, yes, we are supposed to have a meeting at this place.
Why, how did you bribe God? Because I want to be like you. Why are your husband obsessed with WhatsApp chats to go there and see his conversations?
Yes, not easy. Because I used to be feeling trepidation, but now I'm like, you know, if she sees something she doesn't understand.
For example, if his chats, he hasn't read them, I don't need to open because he won't travel.
Then I won't see them.
So, but if it's if we've been talking about something and I want to follow up, I can go back to it and say, you know this? So for me, I don't have a problem with that. Yes.
I should connect. And I know many ladies that are saying, oh my God, that's my dream kind of life. We want to be.
But
like
it's a responsibility. I need to tell you, ladies.
It is.
It is a responsibility in a sense that if I trust you with my WhatsApp chats and you see something and you use the information you've got from there to malign me, that's the last one you're going to read.
Yeah.
Okay? So it's a responsibility.
It goes to maturity.
It works for us because we have developed this thing.
But doesn't work for you.
But it may not work for you instantly. If you find yourself in that privileged position, take that as a responsibility, not something to just mismanage. Because if you mismanage that information, it's going to come back in a very bad way and blow back in your face. So that's you were saying it's important to you, and I'm saying it's not exactly easy, but we have cultivated it because it is
important.
Okay, so now that you have given one from your side, give us one from the gentleman that we haven't mentioned. Apart from sex, what else do you guys need?
Men need to know that you believe in them.
Admiration.
Mm. Mm-hmm. That you don't see me and see all the faults, all the things I should be doing that your father used to do.
Who I should be.
I should be your dad, and I'm not your dad.
Mm.
Or some other guy. Now, worse still, some other guy. Mm. I can tolerate your dad, but some other guy.
You're comparing with someone else's husband.
Someone's husband, the neighbor, or the...
Your sister.
Eh?
Or a socialite.
Yes. Mm. So, do you believe in me?
Yeah.
If I tell you, if I say jump, would you jump without asking why? You know, this is very emancipated.
It depends on who I know. Is asking you to jump.
So if I say, let's go. Mm. If I say, go inside that room and close it, don't open it until I... Would you do it? So why are you bossing me around? I have a mind of my own.
Uh-huh.
You know? So men coil at that kind of response. But if she's okay, I hope you'll explain to me why later. But then you do it. The way Sarah said... to husband, that my lord, you know, that is not Sarah becoming subservient and Abraham becoming boss.
The master.
It is Sarah looking at her husband saying anything you say. You imagine Sarah, the day Isaac and Abraham came from the mountain, and Isaac said, "Do you know?
Daddy almost cut off my head.
Daddy had a knife and a fire." And he was going to cut off my head until a certain sheep showed up. In 21st century.
A child that they waited for until they were 90.
Abraham, are you mad or what?
Mm-hmm.
Have you lost your mind now?
Mm-hmm.
My father would never do something like that. That tears down a man into small pieces.
Mm-hmm.
You know? But she said, why did you do that? She probably never asked even.
Mm-hmm.
Your father, I trust you. Sir, Abraham said, let's go. You leave your parents behind, you just follow me. Now, someone might say, you're advocating for calamity.
Mm.
These men these days, you can't trust, he can take you down a hill.
Mm.
I'm not talking about those men.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm talking about your husband, the one who you left your father and your mother to come and be joined with.
Mm.
Don't give me the litany of all the men in the world. We're talking about one man. Do you believe in him?
Can I ask? Or maybe phrase or ask. Let me just ask. Okay, let me phrase. Must I believe in anybody that is not worth my trust? Because we always want to look for the superhero in you. If you've not built that much trust, like she was saying, if you have not opened yourself, or if you're not living up to that I'm expecting from you, must I, if there's nothing to admire from you, what will I admire?
So it now it flips to the men.
Mm-hmm.
I just spoke to the women.
Exactly.
It flips to the men.
Mm.
Dear husband,
this
thing that we are talking about is a responsibility. You hear me?
Mm-hmm.
It is not for you to sit on a throne and be the king and take everybody wherever you... If you know that this woman has closed her eyes and trusted me, then you should also know that you must handle that in such a way that she will not regret
trusting
having done that.
Mm.
All right? And that's the thing that drives me. And several other men I've found. There are very many good men out there, by the way, who are managing their affairs very well.
Mm.
And they can be trusted. Their wives trust them wholly. And they feel secure in that trust. So it's a responsibility. It's not a time for you now to say, now I can do anything that I want.
Mm.
Since
she trusts me blindly.
But the Bible says, shall we continue sinning so that the grace can increase?
No.
So even here, certainly not.
Mm.
Even here, your wife lends you that trust. It is lent.
Mm-hmm.
She lends you that trust.
Mm-hmm.
It stays as long as it is held in a trustworthy manner.
Yeah.
It can be withdrawn. It should be withdrawn if you mismanage it.
Actually, yeah.
I'm sorry, it should be
withdrawn
if you mismanage it. Mm-hmm. So, it's serious. Again, we are looking at both sides.
Mm-hmm.
The wife should give the husband confidence that I know you can. I don't know how many times she has said, I think you can do that.
Mm-hmm.
You know how I can be walking?
Mm-hmm.
Like, ooh la la.
Like a walking on
the moon. Yes, yes, yes. But also at days when she's like, again, that's the last time I'm trying that thing.
Wow.
Yeah, she's like, that thing never worked last time. So I'm like, okay. Even if I am very sure. And yet there are things which I've done which turned out to be very complicated. Like this sort of stuff we try to do. We try to buy some things in Germany for some supplies and for some people. Mm. And this time, really, we agreed. We agreed to take credits to do that. Did it work? The thing was in my neck like this the whole of last year.
Mm.
You know, we managed to finally solve it, but we didn't make any profit on it.
Wow.
But because we had agreed, I was willing to do everything to make sure that we don't lose that money.
Mm.
You know, I did not go away feeling like I failure because of the way she trusted me. Even when it was not going well, she said, but is this thing working?
Mm.
I said, yeah, they are telling me it's working, but I'm not sure. Maybe it's sad. She's like, hey, but now I'm scared. I'm like, even me, I'm scared. But you know, we went to this one together, so we died together.
Mm.
You know, fortunately, it didn't cause any more damage than it was threatening to cause. But it's important for a guy to feel like the wife
believes
in them.
Mm.
They will do wonders. You try it at home and you'll see. Okay. This one you can try it.
Mm-hmm. All right, okay. Unfortunately or fortunately, we are running out of time pretty fast. I would have loved to have you for part three. And maybe, guys, you should stay tuned. Who knows? This lovely couple might be back in a few weeks or months, of course, to continue sharing their immense expertise and, of course, the anointing that you have. Mchala Msumba, Mwa Msumba, and Mchala Msumba. We appreciate the Lord for you and for allowing you to commit to serving Him. We still have lots of other needs that we should have maybe discussed, but I'm going to recommend you to an episode that we did at the beginning, I think in 2020. It's one of the first episodes we uploaded on our YouTube channel covering all emotional needs. There's sex and affection, there's emotional needs and the love bank, there's recreation, companionship and conversation, and then I summarized the rest. So you go and look for those episodes, on our YouTube channel at Marriage Anchor and watch everything, so that we will not, you know, exceed the time that we are supposed to be having the show run. Okay, so Andrew and Becky, each one of you just give us a parting shot. If there's this one thing that you'd want to give out as far as expectations are concerned, there's a lady that is struggling and they're like, for me, I came into this marriage and I thought this is how everything was supposed to turn out and it has not. What should I do? What would you tell her in a minute?
I believe in the marriage manual, and that's the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll take you straight to Hosea 10:12.
Mm-hmm.
It says, sow for yourselves righteousness. Do good. Don't expect much. Do good. Do your part. Run your lane.
Mm-hmm.
The next one says, you will reap mercy or loving kindness, depending on the version that you're using.
Mm-hmm.
At a time when you can't measure up, what you invested will turn back to
Amen.
You. Like, you will reap mercy. You will not get what you deserve, which is a beautiful thing. Then it says, plow the uncultivated land or the fallow ground. There are places in us that we have not explored. There are areas that you're scared about. So me, I think if you reach out and stretch yourself and immediately after that verse, it says, it's time to seek the Lord. He's the author of marriage. So we have to go back to Him. He sees what we do not see. He does a 360 degree view. We only do 180.
Mm-hmm.
So if you go back to Him and ask Him, show me that area. Show me how I'm supposed to do this.
Mm-hmm.
He will give you the knowledge, the wisdom, and the understanding that you need to manage.
Mm-hmm.
And it says that He will shower on you righteousness. He will show you. He will bring that you looked forward to.
Mm.
Wait on Him. Go back to God because He's the author of marriage.
Amen.
That is what I can say.
Marriage is not a destination. It is a journey. Journey on. Don't take the expectation that has not been met and use it to decide the fate of the marriage. Who knows what might happen in the future? It's a journey. Some of us Once we get married, we think that we have arrived. Mm-hmm. And yet that's when the journey is starting. Mm-hmm. So it's a journey. Take the journey together, grow together, make mistakes together, mm-hmm. learn together, laugh. Mm-hmm. Even if a sad day comes, be sad together. Mm-hmm. You know? Eventually, that which you hoped for will come. Have faith in your own marriage.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And faith is there. Substance of things hoped for. Yes, have faith. Yeah, and also have faith in God. Yes, mm-hmm. have faith in God. And don't just give up. Don't give up. A lot of us give up too quickly. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Don't give up.
Thank you so much once again, Becky. We appreciate you. Mm-hmm. I promise I will send an invitation once again so you can come back. It's a wrap right here in the Garden of Eden. Good night. God bless you.
Thank you for connecting to the Marriage Anchor. For more information, call us on 0702-767-602 or 0782-958-875. Email us at themarriageanchor@gmail.com. Like and follow us on Facebook, The Marriage Anchor. Twitter, Anchor_marriage. Instagram, Marriage_anchor. Check our YouTube channel at Marriage Anchor for all our previous episodes. The Garden of Eden. A test of heaven's romance.
Take me to the garden. I can't resist the feeling. Take me to the garden. I wanna feel my belonging. Take me to the garden. I am yours.
And you are mine.
My heart is yours.
And you alone.
Take me to the garden.